When it comes to high boost turbocharged engines, we can essentially make as much power as we want, provided that we can seal the cylinder head to the engine block. And this is something that's really easy to overlook. With my own background in turbocharged 4G63 drag engines, I'm no stranger to these sorts of problems. Now we're here with Julian from Julian Godfrey Motorsport to talk a little bit about some of the technology that goes into sealing the cylinder head to the block. Now Julian, off camera we were just talking a little bit before about your experience with the 4G63, and in particular you've built some engines that have been used in, is it rallycross?
Radical, yes. With the 45mm restrictor. So then we're obviously running a lot of boost low down, and the problem is trying to seal the head to the block.
Now, with a 45mm restrictor, ultimately that is still going to hold back the maximum amount of power you can make. That restrictor goes pre-turbocharger, restricting the airflow in. So just before we get too far into the engine details, what sort of peak power are you seeing with that 45mm restrictor?
Around about the 580 horsepower. But then we see it close to like 700 pounds of torque down at 4,000 RPM. So that's what really does the damage.
Yeah, I think that's the part that most people would overlook. So it's why I want to focus on it. I mean, 500, 600 horsepower these days is sort of the streetcar level for a lot of people. So it's not unheard of. Yeah. But the problem is, as you say, that torque down low. And what sort of boost pressure are you running down at sort of 4,000 RPM?
It was actually hitting 3 bar of boost. So it's a lot of cylinder pressure. Yeah. And we're sort of running 9, 9.5 to 1 compression ratio. So it's a very high compression ratio at 3 bar of boost.
Okay, so explain to us there the mechanics of why this causes a problem with head gasket integrity.
But because the cylinder piston speed is very low at 4,000 RPM, it doesn't release the pressure very quickly, so it's a lot of cylinder pressure for a long time, and that's why the things like head gaskets just struggle at low RPM. And
I think for most people, they sort of look at an engine block or a cylinder head when it's sitting on a workbench, and it all looks nice and rigid and pretty solid. But when you're talking about those sort of cylinder pressures for a long period of time, what's easy to overlook is that those components are actually flexing a lot. So you actually see the cylinder head and the block sort of essentially flex apart. Yeah. What sort of, how much movement would you expect you are getting in there?
Well, especially with the 4G63, there is actually a lot of flex in the block. It's actually... Well, the block is a very early design. I think it's from the 70s, isn't it? Early 70s, the block. And the actual stud bosses inside underneath the deck are not going into anything. They just sit into fresh air underneath. So it's all is just a thin deck to hold them down. And I did a little test when couldn't keep a head on a gasket on a 4G63. I just put some little oil control rings on top of each bore, put the head on there, and just torqued it up to just 15 lb-ft, and straight away the block was installed in. And you go up to 35-40 and it's sorted to 20 foul. So there's no point putting big studs in there because it's the blocks the problem.
I think that's sort of easy to overlook there. Sort of the general trend is when you're taking a stock 4G63 and you want to make more power and run more boost, the general off-the-shelf components most people will go for would be a multi-layer steel head gasket and a set of perhaps ARP studs, which provide a little bit more clamping. So you're saying that the studs really aren't the issue there, because as you clamp the head to the block, it's actually distorting due to the thickness of the deck surface?
Yeah, that's right. And the more you torque the stud up, the more it distorts it before you even put any cylinder pressure in there.
So you could think that you're actually making things better, but the reality is you're making your life harder right from the get-go, even before you add boost?
That's right. You're probably almost maybe better off on standard bolts, a bit more softer bolts, and it would last longer. So eventually we actually went to a 12mm steel plate on top of the block to try and stiffen up the deck face.
All right, so just talk us through that process. How does that work? Because that's not something that we see a lot of people doing, and there's probably a fair bit of work involved in doing that.
Yeah, it is a lot of work doing that, because Aussie changed all the cambelt length, and so you have to sort that side of things out, and exhaust manifold, inner manifold is hidden higher in the engine bay. So it's a lot of work to change it, but in the end, that was the only way we could keep one together on a rallycross car, is a 12mm steel plate with a flange liner on going into the steel plate.
So that steel plate, first of all, the thickness of it, 12mm, plus the material strength, that gives you that rigidity that you need in the deck surface to stop it from moving around?
That's right. It keeps it nice and flat there. And then you can, once we've done this 12mm steel plate, we did the same test with these oil control rings on top of the bores, took the head down, and then it wouldn't move at all. Obviously, once you got up to about 75-80, it started to move a little bit. but it was so much better than the standard setup.
Now, there's a couple of technical aspects that you're going to need to deal with there. First of all, that steel plate being placed on top of the cast iron block. Obviously, you've got water jackets, you've got oil galleries, you've got oil returns. So how are you sealing those on the underside of that steel plate?
So on the underside, we've got O-rings in machined in the steel plate for the oil feeds, the returns, and the waterways. And then on top, we still use... We actually found the best on top was two standard gaskets on top of each other, the two with the half mil gaskets, and that was gives us our best result.
So no requirements for anything too flash like O-rings, etc.
No, just the two standard gaskets on top of each other, and that cured the problem, and we've never had a problem since.
Now the other aspect there, you've obviously now got this plate on top, so you've talked about the flanged liner. So can you talk us through what that is and how that works?
We use the steel Nikasil liner, flange liner, which was counterboarded at the top of the steel plate, and then the gasket actually sat on top of the firing ring sat on top of the flange liner, so that was pushing on top of the liner, which was pushing on the steel plate, and then the bolts were pulling from underneath the steel plate from the block, and it just kept it much squarer when you've got the high cylinder pressures.
With the steel material that you've used for that sleeve, stronger than a cast iron material, so do you get away with quite a thin sleeve when you're using steel?
Yeah, we're down to just, I think, 1 millimeter thickness of steel liner. Because you've got very small bore centres with the 4G63, you can't go too big on the liners anyway, because they'd be into each other.
And you mentioned that Nikasil coating as well, so can you just talk us through why that's required on a steel liner?
You can't run a steel ring onto steel, so you have to change the material surface. So we get them Nikasil coated, and then get the piston ring tritinitrided. It's like a gold coating on the ring to stop the rings from picking up on the Nikasil.
Now the other aspect there with adding a 12mm deck plate to the top of the block there, that's going to allow you to run a longer connecting rod in order to get your deck height for your piston correct or back to where it should be. So are you taking advantage of that in terms of rod to stroke ratio, or are you using a stroker crankshaft and still retaining a reasonable rod to stroke ratio?
No, we just made a longer rod because we're governed on the CC of the engine for the regulations with 2 litres, so we still use the standard stroke, but just longer rod, which helped the rod ratio.
Is that a real advantage though, when with that 45mm restrictor, you're obviously limited in terms of maximum RPM? We generally see the longer rod to stroke ratio really come into its own as the RPM range sort of increases.
Yeah, I don't think there's a great advantage of actual power performance, but it may be slightly less stress on the components, again, because you've got less angle as it's pushing the piston down. All that angle with high cylinder pressure is all going to help if you've got a longer rod.
All right, look, great to get some insight from a completely different form of motorsport than I'm used to, and how to deal with the 4G63 problems. Certainly something that potentially we could have looked into ourselves. If people want to find out more about you and your company, how can they reach out, Julian?
RaceTuners.com, so quite an easy one to remember.
All right, thanks a lot for the chat, Julian.
Thanks very much, no problem.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.